something like Golden Sun for Game Boy Advance is a rare occurrence. It's an original, not a sequel, well, it doesn't have to be. You know, it's not a spin-off, not a remake, not a port. It's an original game on a handheld system. A really good quality one. In fact, many people argue it's like the best game on the Game Boy Advance. Of course, I played it on DS Lite, but because it's backwards compatible with Game Boy Advance. But, you know, regardless, it is considered as like one of the best, if not the best game on the Game Boy Advance. So, it's an incredible game, it's very original, it's really entertaining RPG. You know, so the first notable thing with any other game is the visuals. And I admit, I'm not very experienced when it comes to like judging the graphic quality of Game Boy Advance games, because I haven't played that many of them. But I do tend to view the Game Boy Advance's capability as comparable to those of the Super Nintendo. So I do have a basic idea of just how amazing Golden Sun's sprite work and animations are. Far beyond those basic things, the artistic design, the use of down-to-earth colors, and the sheer size of the game are many of the things that exemplify the technical prowess of the game. There's no waiting time nor load time of any kind, and this is a feat that even the sequel, The Golden Sun, The Lost Age, wasn't able to accomplish, since The Lost Age has some kind of a really tiny waiting time when you save the game. Technicalities aside, the hand-drawn environments featured in this game are simply gorgeous to look at, especially since there are so many different kinds of environments to explore. Even the overworld screen, which is blurry and fuzzy as they come, is rather impressive compared to other Super Nintendo JRPGs of the similar caliber. So, let's move aside from the graphics, I mean, since it is a very outdated game in that sense. It's, for the most part, Golden Sun is very traditional, meaning normal encounters are randomly triggered, and that combat in these encounters are turn-based, not active. There are other staple features such as respawning at the nearest church with half the gold missing when the party is wiped out, and characters getting experience to level up the more they encounter and defeat enemy monsters. So those used to the genre, and especially those familiar with Dragon Quest games, will no doubt feel like they've already played this game before, maybe just with different art style and different characters. But, as with any masterful role-playing game, especially in the Eastern side, the Japanese RPG, the unique differences and innovations are really subtle. But in this genre, it's the subtleties that really make a title truly stand out. Other than the huge novelty of the Dijin system, which I'll get to talking about later, much of the unique aspects of Golden Sun are very subtle. Special abilities in this game are called Synergy, that's with the P-S-Y-N-E-R-G-Y, and these abilities cause Synergy Points, or PP, to use. The subtle difference here is that PP automatically recharges slowly as you explore out of combat. This slight difference makes the experience much more streamlined and worry-free, so you don't have to explore the entire world in search of mana potions or any items that replenish the PP. You just have to kind of walk around without engaging in combat. And this is especially streamlined when the game requires the use of these abilities outside of the battles in order to pass through the game's many thought-provoking environmental puzzles. So you'll be using synergy abilities outside of combat as well. It also allows gamers to use all kinds of strategies, even for normal encounters, without having to worry too much about running out of PP, as long as you use diverse tactics to attack without using up PP from time to time. Another big subtle difference is the fact that characters will only attack the enemy that they have targeted. Many gamers who mistakenly and foolishly claim that all JRPGs play the same do not realize just how this one subtle difference in mechanic changes everything, including combat tactics and strategy. JRPG really is a genre in which innovations or uniqueness are not easy to spot, but it's also a genre in which little differences can turn a day into night and vice versa. In the case of Golden Sun, the game chooses to utilize the archaic JRPG design of characters automatically choosing to defend when someone else defeats their targeted enemy. In many other RPGs, especially the more modern ones, when this happens, the character will usually attack the next enemy who's alive. No such autonomy exists in Golden Sun, which forces players to be more strategic and tactical when panning out moves. It can also be kind of, this design choice in particular can be problematic, can be frustrating, because it makes some random battles unnecessarily drawn out. So, for example, you know, it's just a random battle, all you're going to do is attack, 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 right? But because you have like three enemies or something, and you have four characters, And in this one turn, your four characters wiped out the two enemies. And it's your fourth character's turn, but since his target has been wiped out, he's not going to attack, he's going to defend. So you have to actually go to the next turn to finish the battle. So in that way, it's unnecessarily drawn out, and it can kind of feel like this design choice is just, it's unnecessary. But so in, because of this, the design can feel kind of outdated and be very off-putting to those used to more modern RPGs where combat is much more streamlined. But it is an intentional design choice forced to make you think more strategically, I guess, in a way. Most people have a tendency to overlook these subtle differences. So let's talk about something that doesn't seem so minor or so subtle, which is the Dijin system. Dijins are spelled really interesting. It's D-J-I-N-N. I don't even know if I'm pronouncing it correctly. But Dijins are these little furry little creatures that come in four different elemental forms. The elements being ice slash water, fire, earth, and wind. You know, the typical four elements. They're never even mentioned in the game's story because the story of the game instead focuses on the mysterious nature of Synergy and its practitioners. But in regards to gameplay and combat, I think nothing is more important in Golden Sun than Dijins. These creatures are scattered throughout the world for players to collect so that each can be assigned to different characters to initiate special moves. It can also change character classes, or it can even conjure up devastating summons. The more Dijins are collected, the more options there are in what kind of classes can be formed and what kind of summons become available. Certain synergy abilities can be accessed only by the character having the right combination of Dijin equipped. This makes for a rather tedious micromanagement of Dijins for characters, but it definitely makes Golden Sun unique and fresh from the other JRPGs on the market. Having to unequip and equip each Dijin every time to use summons before engaging in battles is really annoying, and use of Dijins changing the class of characters during battles can be disorienting, because it's just like you're used to this one character, but then all of a sudden, because you used the Dijin to summon, his class has totally changed, and so his special abilities have changed, and getting used to that takes getting used to. Let's see, where am I? But, you know, even though that may be the case, it's using Dijins can be really fun, and it can be really addicting to try to collect every single one of the Dijins in the game. Each Dijin also features different special moves, adding yet another layer of depth to the strategy, especially in boss battles. The last boss battle in particular requires well-calculated use of Dijins, because otherwise, no matter how powerful your characters are, respawning at the nearest church is pretty much inevitable. With all this said, however, what makes Golden Sun the masterpiece that it is doesn't really have much to do with the game's combat mechanics. I mean, the mechanics are fairly innovative and engaging, but unlike many JRPGs out there, the best thing about Golden Sun is its level design for its dungeons. I mentioned that synergy abilities can be used outside of battle to solve environmental puzzles, and the game focuses heavily on this aspect. With synergy, allowing characters to have abilities such as move, it's called move, which is pretty much telepathically moving certain poles. An ability called lift, which can hold huge obstacles up in the air for a certain duration. Mind read, where you can read people's mind. Grow, which enlarges plants into like climbable ladders, etc. The game always requires critical thinking to get past the obstacles. Coming out of a dungeon is extremely rewarding because of this. Furthermore, extra areas and dungeons hide extra Dijins and special items you can obtain by overcoming other concealed environmental puzzles. Unlike many other open-world JRPGs, players will not have trouble wondering where to go next to continue the story. The overall design is pretty straightforward, with areas that you shouldn't go to usually blocked off or placed at the end of a path that you would have to go out of your way to follow. Instead, if gamers do get stuck in Golden Sun, it will be because the game's environmental puzzle will have him or her stumped. Most of these require serious thinking, especially the ones you'll encounter in Crossbone Island, an optional dungeon housing some of the game's best gear. It's after completing these environmental puzzles that it becomes clear that the developers behind this game are truly talented. The mage-like aspect of this game is one of the many things that make this game stand out so well against other similar games. The last thing to mention about Golden Sun is its unique way of storytelling. Like the gameplay mechanics, the story presentation is actually very traditional, with simple dialogues that simply tell you what to do and where to go next. The protagonist also doesn't talk, other than saying yes or no, which you get to choose, but it actually has no actual consequences in the story. There aren't any crazy twists, and the pacing is pretty sluggish up to the middle point, but it has a charming way of presenting itself with characters that display emotes like smiley faces or frowny faces during dialogues. Sometimes there's a little too much emoting, and that's what bogs down the storytelling a bit, but the way it develops itself into the climax is captivating and enjoyable. Though the game ends with a weird cliffhanger, by the end of it all, you truly get the sense that you've gone through so much and that it was one hell of an adventure. I really disliked how nothing in the game is really explained, but at the same time, this created a sense of mystery and suspense at the motivation to keep playing the game. I definitely would have preferred to have seen much more interesting dialogues with non-playable characters, and would have loved to see mind readability be incorporated much more often. But the story is still told masterfully, and I kind of feel like I'm asking a bit too much when I say all this, you know, when I'm nitpicking all this. Regardless, by this point, I really hope I have explained well enough why Golden Sun is such a special game, not only for the Game Boy Advance, but also for pretty much the industry as a whole. You'll have noticed in this video that many of the minor things that can be, that I talked about can be kind of troubling, such as the often tedious nature of the Dijin system, and the storytelling, which kind of can feel bogged down, and there's too many questions that are never answered. But then, you should have also realized that I didn't dwell too much on those minor design flaws. Of course, I didn't even bring up my dislike of the way item management is done in this game. But with the game this special and this amazing, it's rather easy for me to forget about the things that bother me a bit about the game. But of course, the very first paragraph, the introduction of me saying, you know, it's one of the best games on the Gordon's and the Game Boy Advance system should have made it obvious how much I love this game and how much I think this game is really special. Not just for the Game Boy Advance, but I think this game could really compete with a lot of the similar competition on the home consoles itself, not just on the handheld market. So it's a really remarkable game. If you do, I just simply love this game, and I really great game. I don't really think I can say the same thing for the sequel, even though I haven't completed the sequel, but that's really for another video, I guess.